The Subcommittee on Energy will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recesses of the Subcommittee at any time, which we might go ahead and do. Have y'all eaten breakfast? So I want to thank y'all for being here today. Today's hearing is entitled Innovations in Battery Storage for Renewable Energy. I recognize myself for 5 minutes for an opening statement. Today we will hear from government and industry witnesses on the state of large-scale battery storage and recent technology breakthroughs achieved through research and development at the national labs and universities around the country. Our witnesses today will also provide insight into how innovative companies are transitioning basic science research in battery storage technology to the energy marketplace. Energy storage could revolutionize electricity generation and delivery in America. Cost-effective, large-scale batteries could change the way we power our homes, reduce infrastructure improvement costs, and allow renewable energy to add power to the electric grid without compromising reliability or increasing consumer costs. As a Texan, trust me, I know the value of reliable, affordable energy. With a population in Texas that is increasing by 1,000 people a day or more, and energy-intensive industries driving consumption, Texas is by far the nation's largest consumer of electricity. The Texas economy needs reliable and affordable energy to power long-term growth, plain and simple. With battery storage technology, Texas could count on power from conventional and renewable energy sources, regardless of the weather, saving money for Texas consumers and keeping the Texas power grid reliable and secure. Although large-scale battery storage has been available for decades, there's still more work to be done. Fundamental research and development into the atomic and molecular structure of batteries is needed to better understand the operation, performance limitations, and the failures of battery technology. At our national labs, we have the facilities and expertise necessary to conduct this basic research. The private sector plays an instrumental role in commercializing next-generation battery technology. Through partnerships with the national labs, innovative battery companies can take advantage of cutting-edge research and user facilities and develop cost-effective, efficient energy storage technology that can compete in today's energy marketplace. Instead of duplicating deployment efforts that can be done by the private sector, the federal government should prioritize basic research and development on energy storage. This investment in energy storage technology, R&D, can benefit all forms of energy while maintaining that reliability and the security of the nation's electric grid. Current U.S. policy for advancing the deployment of renewable energy is built around federal subsidies and tax credits, but these policies only tend to increase costs for the American people and are counterproductive to the development of battery storage technology that could make renewable power a good investment in the real world. By creating an incentive to invest in renewable energy deployment instead of energy storage, the federal government is actually steering investment away from battery storage technology. And the truth is, without affordable and efficient energy storage, renewable energy will never be able to match the efficiency, affordability, and reliability of fossil fuels. Instead, the federal government should end market-distorting subsidies and tax credits for the renewable energy industry and allocate those resources to basic research and development necessary to solve the challenge of energy storage. I want to thank our witnesses for testifying to the committee today, and I look forward to a discussion about federal energy storage research and development and the impact efficient and affordable batteries can have on energy reliability and security. I now recognize the ranking member, the gentleman from Florida, for an opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Weber, for holding this hearing, and thank you to our witnesses this morning for participating. Today we'll be discussing energy storage and the potential benefits that can be gained by developing storage technologies. Energy storage has the potential to solve problems such as interruptions in power on the electric grid. We all know how frustrating and at times even dangerous a power outage can be, and to make intermittent renewable sources of energy more practical and affordable. Energy storage allows the buying of energy when prices are low and the selling of energy when prices are high. This capability can lead to a reduction in energy congestion on America's electrical infrastructure, lowering prices for consumers, and also potentially lowering utility revenues for providers. We have to plan that out accordingly. Well-placed storage units can eliminate the need for building additional transmission lines in some areas, saving consumers money. These challenges to existing energy infrastructure business models will grow as residential storage systems become more affordable. Japan, according to Bloomberg Business, is set to spend $670 million in response to the grid issues that it's facing so that it'll be able to accommodate the influx of renewable energy, which is often intermittently produced. In contrast, our Department of Energy's Office of Electricity Storage Program was funded at only $12 million, that's $670 million versus $12 million, for fiscal year 2015. We need to do better than this if we want to maintain a reliable, resilient electric grid that can accommodate the many new forms of energy production storage that are emerging today. Lawrence Berkeley National Lab estimated that the annual costs associated with interruptions in power are as high as $135 billion, and often it's the commercial and industrial sectors of our economy that bear those costs. In a future in which manufacturing processes increasingly rely on digital technology, even short, brief outages can dramatically impact production and sales. Energy storage solutions provide a line of defense against the costs of an outage, and it is imperative that America be prepared to incorporate storage solutions into energy and electrical infrastructure. If we invest wisely, research programs in electrical and energy storage can help America move from our current 20th century energy grid to a future grid that delivers more and pollutes less. And federally funded research has the potential to create new product lines, new business opportunities, and new international markets. Storage technology can make America's energy future arrive faster, and that's always our goal, to make the future arrive faster. Again, I thank each of our witnesses for being here today, and I look forward to hearing what each of you has to say. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back my time.
Thank you, Mr. Grayson, and I now recognize the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thought I'd mention to members at least part of the reason and part of the genesis for this hearing today. A couple of years ago, I was meeting in my office with the author of a Pulitzer Prize-winning book on energy. His name is Daniel Yergin, and I suspect many of you have heard of him. He also happens to have been a college classmate. And I asked him what was the single most important thing we could do to help consumers with energy. And he replied, develop a better battery or develop a battery that had better storage capability. And even though that conversation took place a couple of years ago, that really led to today's hearing. And so that's how important I think it is and how important at least one other expert thinks the development of better battery storage is as well. Mr. Chairman, today the Subcommittee on Energy will examine breakthrough technology in battery storage for renewable energy. Battery storage is the next frontier in energy research and development. Advanced batteries will help bring affordable renewable energy to the market without costly subsidies or renewable energy mandates. 45% of new U.S. power production last year came from wind turbines, while solar power made up 34% of new global power capacity. But without the capacity to efficiently store the energy produced when the sun isn't shining and the wind isn't blowing, renewable energy makes a minimal contribution to America's electricity needs. Advanced battery technology will enable utilities to store and deliver power produced by renewable energy. This will allow us to take advantage of energy from the diverse natural resources available across the country. My home state of Texas offers a ready example of the impact battery storage could have on harnessing renewable power. Texas is the top wind-producing state in the country. Lone Star State currently operates more than 12,000 megawatts of utility-scale wind capacity, about one-fifth of the total wind capacity in the United States. in ideal circumstances, wind generates up to 18% of Texas's power. But even with this significant capacity, Texas wind energy cannot produce power on demand. And when energy needs are the highest, wind makes up just 3% of Texas power generation. Advanced battery technology could help the U.S. meet its energy needs and effectively manage its power production when conventional and renewable energy resources, which will save money for energy consumers. Federal research and development can build the foundation for the next breakthrough in battery technology. Mr. Chairman, I know votes have been cast, so I'd like to ask unanimous consent that the rest of my opening statement be made a part of the record so that we can at least get our witnesses introduced before we need to leave for votes. And then I know members will return after that. I'll yield back.
Without objection, thank you. Let me introduce our witnesses. Our first witness today is Dr. Imru Juk. Okay, good German name. The Energy Storage Program Manager for the Department of Energy's Office of Electricity Delivery and Energy Reliability. His work involves research on a wide variety of technologies, including advanced batteries, flywheels, supercapacitors, and compressed air energy storage. Dr. Juk received his bachelor's degree from Fordham University and his PhD in theoretical physics from Purdue University. Our next witness is Dr. Virden, Associate Laboratory Director for the Energy and Environment Directorate at Pacific Northwest National Laboratory. Now, that's a mouthful. At PNNL, Dr. Virden leads a team of 1,000 staff in delivering science and technology solutions for energy and environmental challenges. And he's been with the lab for over 2 decades. Dr. Virden holds 2 United States patents and has received R&D 100 and Federal Laboratory Consortium Awards for non-thermal plasma technology, a Discover Award with MIT for fuel reformation technologies, and he contributed to a Financial Times Global Automotive Award for PNNL's assistant to Delphi's non-thermal plasma technology for automotive applications. Dr. Virden earned his bachelor's degree and PhD in chemical engineering from the University of Washington. Welcome. Mr. Giudice. Actually, I'm going to yield to the gentlewoman from Massachusetts because I think she knows something about him to introduce him.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It is my pleasure to introduce Mr. Phil Giudice, the CEO of Ambry and a constituent of mine from Wayland, Massachusetts. Ambry is a technology company in Massachusetts that is creating cost-effective and reliable battery technology that has the potential to revolutionize the grid. Phil, in addition to leading Ambry, has more than 30 years of experience throughout the energy industry. He has worked as a geologist, a consultant, a manager, and a public servant. I will highlight just a few of his many, many accomplishments on his resume. Phil is a board member for First Fuel, an efficiency startup, Advanced Energy Economy and Energy Business Leadership Trade Group, and the New England Clean Energy Council. He was an appointee to the Department of Energy's Energy Efficiency and Renewables Advisory Committee, as well as its State Energy Advisory Board. And he has served the Commonwealth as Undersecretary of Energy and Commissioner of the State's Department of Energy Resources. I want to thank you, Phil, and the entire panel for joining us today, and we look forward to your testimony. I yield back.
I thank the gentlewoman from Massachusetts. Our final witness today is Dr. J. Whitaker, Founder and Chief Technology Officer for Aquion Energy. Dr. Whitaker became an assistant professor at Carnegie Mellon in 2007 with a joint appointment in material science and engineering and public policy departments, where he developed the chemistry that is the basis for Aquion Energy's product line. Dr. Whitaker received his bachelor's degree in physics from Oberlin College and received his master's and PhD in material science and engineering from the University of Michigan. That concludes the introduction of the witnesses, and unfortunately, as the chairman said, they have called votes, so we're going to recess, and then we will reconvene immediately after the last vote on the floor. The subcommittee stands in recess. We're going to reconvene this hearing, and we're going to recognize our first witness, Dr. Juke.
Chairman Smith, Chairman Weber, Ranking Member Grayson, and members of the committee, thank you for your invitation to testify at today's hearing. I appreciate the opportunity to tell you about the energy storage program of DOE's Office of Electricity Delivery and Energy Reliability, and the serious efforts the program is making to address the challenges facing the widespread deployment of grid energy storage. I'm pleased to be part of this panel with some of my distinguished colleagues who have been great partners over the years. Last week, the administration released the first ever quadrennial energy review. The QER takes a broad look at the infrastructure used for the transmission, storage, and distribution of energy. Several of the QER findings and recommendations address the opportunities that grid energy storage can provide to modernize the electric grid. Today, I would like to highlight our work over the last dozen years to develop energy storage technology, working on materials and devices, and to bring them into commercialization. The program is firmly based on the knowledge and expertise of the national laboratories. We work with Sandia, with Pacific Northwest Laboratory, and Oak Ridge in a fully integrated program which produces cutting-edge research focused on commercialization. And this focus on commercialization is essential. We also involve universities and industry as appropriate. We pursue a wide portfolio of technologies for a broad spectrum of applications. Some of the technologies we have studied include advanced lead carbon batteries, sodium ion systems, magnesium ion systems, and flow batteries involving vanadium, zinc iodide, and organometallics. We bring promising chemistries all the way from basic investigations through device development and into licensing and deployment. I would like to share some success stories in deploying energy storage technologies and then discuss how OE's program is addressing the major challenges. At No Trees, a small town near Odessa in West Texas, we partnered with Duke Energy to build a 36-megawatt facility for wind smoothing and frequency regulation. The installation helped to inform the Texas Public Utility Commission on developing rules for ancillary services. Tehachapi, California, is the site of the world's largest wind field. But sometimes the wind blows and sometimes it doesn't. And so we partnered with Southern California Edison to build an 8-megawatt, 4-hour lithium-ion facility to mitigate the variable nature of the wind. I believe strongly that federal programs need to work directly with the states, making the expertise developed by the national laboratories available to the public. For example, in Vermont, we are partnering with the Public Service Department to build a disaster-resilient microgrid combining 4 megawatts of storage with 2 megawatts of photovoltaics. During emergencies, the facility can function as a community shelter and maintain critical services indefinitely, even without input from the surrounding grid, which may well be down. In Detroit, we are exploring a community energy storage concept, incorporating reused electrical vehicle batteries. In Washington State, we are leveraging state funds to commercialize a battery technology that started with research at PNNL. Avista just inaugurated a 1-megawatt, 3-hour flow battery based on vanadium a few weeks ago. And 2 megawatts with Snohomish will soon follow. We will evaluate the operation of the facility and make careful cost-benefit evaluations. DOE has developed a strategic energy storage plan, which identifies 4 priorities which form the framework for the OE storage program. 1 is lowering costs. That comes first. 2 is validating reliability and safety. 3 is helping to develop an equitable regulatory environment for storage. and four is furthering industry acceptance. The program has provided key leadership in establishing energy storage as an effective tool for promoting grid reliability, resiliency, and better asset utilization of renewable energy. Although grid energy storage has made a credible beginning, much remains to be done. DOE looks forward to continuing this important work. As our electric grid evolves, we expect that energy storage will be an integral component in assuring that electricity delivery for communities, business, and industry will be more flexible, secure, reliable, and environmentally responsive. Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, this completes my prepared statement. I will be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Doctor. And we're going to move to our second witness, Dr. Virden.
Chairman Smith, Chairman Weber, Ranking Member Grayson, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to testify in today's hearing. My primary message today is that even with the tremendous amount of excitement about the emerging U.S. energy storage market, there is still plenty of need for R&D innovations that increase performance, reduce life cycle costs, and improve safety of the next generation of battery storage technologies. The presence of Aquian and Ambry here are evidence of the role of innovative researchers. For our part, I am very proud of PNNL's battery scientists and engineers who have produced close to 300 publications, have filed 91 U.S. patents with 19 granted so far, and 7 licenses to U.S.-based companies in Washington State, California, and Massachusetts. One of these companies, Una Energy Technologies, or UET, was started by 2 former PNNL employees, scientists, in 2012. UET has grown to 50 employees, and they are now deploying their novel redox flow battery technology in Washington, California, and Germany. PNNL recently published the first in-situ scientific investigation looking at the atomic level changes in lithium-ion batteries that enabled us to visualize why they short out and fail. The expected lifetime of lithium-ion battery systems today is generally believed to be 5 to 7 years, and grid storage batteries will need to last ideally 15 to 20 years. This groundbreaking work also confirmed a new approach that might dramatically extend the lifetime of lithium-ion batteries. But despite all these advances, we still have fundamental gaps in our understanding of the basic processes that influence battery operation, performance, limitations, and failures. As you know, renewable energy creates many challenges for grid operations. Their generation profile does not match up exactly with demand, and their generation is intermittent. In the Pacific Northwest, we have 5 gigawatts of wind, and sometimes hundreds of megawatts or even gigawatts of ramps. Texas has the same problem with wind, and California with solar. Battery storage could solve these problems by smoothing out the intermittent generation and storing energy off-peak to be used later when it was most needed. Several of our PNNL studies have concluded that for battery storage to be viable, it must serve multiple grid applications, such as meeting energy demands minute by minute, hour by hour, storing renewable energy at night for use the next day, as well as deferring transmission and distribution upgrades. Utilities would like battery storage to deliver both high power and lots of energy. This is like wanting a car that has the power of a Corvette, the fuel efficiency of a Chevy Malibu, and the price tag of a Chevy Spark. This is hard to do. No one battery delivers both high power and high energy, at least not very well or for very long. There are many different types of battery chemistries and sizes of batteries. In demonstrations around the country, I have counted over 13 different types and sizes of batteries being explored. All are in different stages of development, validation, and demonstration for grid applications. While today's batteries can address the higher value-added grid applications, the cost of batteries need to be reduced, the lifetime expanded, and the safety validated. We believe there are 3 key research and development challenges that need to be addressed to significantly improve existing advanced battery systems in the near term, along with the longer term development of the next generation lower cost battery systems. First, to provide confidence to utilities that new battery technologies will meet multiple grid applications, we need independent testing and evaluation of energy storage technologies to validate performance and safety, along with the continued development of codes and standards that allow interoperability between different technologies and software. Secondly, continued support for basic and applied R&D is needed to discover new battery systems and to better understand and predict why batteries don't perform as expected, why performance degrades over time, or why they fail. Universities and national labs across the country are well positioned to address the gap in our lack of fundamental understanding. Finally, as new technologies make it out of the lab, we will need regional field demonstrations that validate the life cycle cost, performance, safety, and overall impact on batteries will have on reliability, resiliency, and renewable integration. This information is critical to feed back to those developing the next generation of batteries. Thank you for the opportunity to testify, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Virden. Mr. Giudice, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Weber, Chairman Smith, and Ranking Member Grayson. Appreciate the opportunity to testify today. I'm the CEO, President, Board Member of AMBRI, and as you know by having this hearing, energy storage has the potential to transform our electricity grid in a very positive and productive ways. Right now, the grid needs to meet, for every instant of the day, everywhere, the supply of electricity with the demand for electricity, and storage will change everything. Today in the U.S., one of the ways we meet our peak demand is with simple cycle combustion turbines, and the capacity factor for those engines is 2%. Literally, only 160 hours a year are those engines being driven to meet the peak demands, and storage could change everything. If we are able to meet average demand instead of peak demand, we could actually reduce the amount of grid infrastructure investment by approximately half of what our traditional market is. So there are many different ways that storage could help. I'm going to suggest six different areas for the federal government leadership that would be particularly of interest. And I'll give you a little story about AMBRI in the context of that. First is ARPA-E program. So ARPA-E funded campus research at MIT, Dr. Sadoway, to look at a very interesting application for his life's work, which was electrometallurgical refining. And basically, he took the same kinds of processes that are known in the aluminum smelter world of taking a ton of dirt and running electricity through it to produce pure aluminum metal at 50 cents a pound, and said, what if we could make those processes reversible so that we not only take enormous amounts of electricity off the grid, but we could turn it around and put it back on the grid? And it was kind of an interesting concept, a white paper sort of exercise, that attracted funding from ARPA-E in 2007-2008 timeframe. The $7 million grant from ARPA-E made all the difference in the world. This was a concept that there was no private money, no other public money that was willing to step up and see if this idea could work. With that investment plus other private sources, Dr. Sadoway and then Dr. Bradwell were able to drive research on campus to actually prove that this concept works, and works rather remarkably. They had a team that was up to 20 folks on campus advancing this technology, which then enabled the company to come together as a private enterprise and seek private financing. We're now 50 people and completely privately financed with investments from Bill Gates, Total, Khosla Ventures, the KLP Enterprises, and GVB. And we're employed 50 folks, and we're out there now delivering our technology to the marketplace. So we were formed in 2010. We're just now manufacturing our prototypes, and we'll begin delivering them this fall. And those go to very interesting customers, including the U.S. Department of Defense in Massachusetts and Connecticut, Joint Base Cape Cod and Subbase in Groton, Connecticut, Con Ed in New York, Alaska Energy Authority in Alaska, and then in Hawaii, two prototypes are scheduled to go there end of this year, beginning of next year, as well as our first 1 megawatt hour battery storage solution to the U.S. Navy at Pearl Harbor towards the end of 2016. So this federal money that was able to sort of get behind a concept and become sort of an interesting possible technology is now developing itself and being delivered into the commercial marketplace and looking very, very attractive. So one role I encourage is continued support for ARPA-E and the work that they're doing. And five other possibilities include continued support on demonstration projects through the Department of Defense and the Department of Energy, Third is to continued work with states and Federal Energy Regulatory Commission to help them understand and appreciate the full value of storage. There's a very clear and compelling need between states' roles and rights and the federal government in terms of helping to educate and appreciate the value that storage can provide. And then two other areas I'd touch on. One is the loan guarantee program, which, of course, has gotten a lot of coverage. I think plays a very interesting role and could be very helpful from storage, both from manufacturing and demonstration projects. Federal tax credits and including in master limited partnership clean energy investments as possibilities to help this nascent technology that the U.S. in fact has the best research going on and the best new companies started to really bear full fruit and become a world dominant provider. So I'm excited to be here today and look forward to taking any questions that you might have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ducey. Dr. Whitaker, you're up.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for inviting me to speak today on the innovation in grid-scale energy storage. I'd also want to acknowledge the bipartisan Center's American Energy Innovation Council for working with your staff on setting up this important hearing. I am the founder and chief technology officer of Aquion Energy. I'm also still a professor of material science and engineering public policy at Carnegie Mellon University. 7 years ago, I set out to solve the problem of making large-scale energy storage systems that are high performance, safe, sustainable, and cost effective. The solution we developed is an aqueous hybrid ion intercalation battery, which is a mouthful, I know, but it's simple. It uses a saltwater electrolyte, manganese oxide cathode, carbon composite anode, and synthetic cotton separator. We chose these materials because they are made from safe, cheap, and abundant elements, which will make a technology cost of around $100 per kilowatt hour achievable when produced at scale. The battery performs remarkably well, providing long-duration discharges of up to 20 continuous hours while maintaining performance over thousands of cycles and thus many years of operation. We now have over 130 employees and a full-scale manufacturing facility in western Pennsylvania, as well as a satellite office in Boston. We have been shipping product to customers since mid-2014, and our batteries are now deployed or under testing with service providers in 18 states who serve, in theory, millions of customers. Our products have also been exported overseas to Germany, Australia, Malaysia, the UK, and the Philippines, among other locations. The story of Aquion is indicative of the kind of public-private partnership behind many game-changing energy technologies. The idea for Aquion's battery came out of my research at Carnegie Mellon, which was actually informed by my 7 years working as a senior staff scientist at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Shortly after arriving at Carnegie Mellon, I started a small exploratory project on this sodium ion battery chemistry that resulted in some key early results. This allowed me to garner some seed funding from a venture capital firm that allowed me to incubate the concept at a university for a year or so until some critical performance goals were achieved in the lab. At that point, we decided to try and start a real company. And at the same time, we applied for and received Department of Energy funding, which was matched by private investors, to set up the facility focused on prototyping battery units, build a pilot scale production line, and demonstrate performance in a grid-connected environment. Additionally, that funding supported continuing basic research at Carnegie Mellon, the results of which helped us refine the technology and our manufacturing processes at the company. After pilot production and demonstrating the performance of the technology, Aquion was able to raise multiple rounds of private investment that has allowed us to scale and commercialize our batteries. Without this DOE partnership, our early days would have been far more challenging, and perhaps Aquion would not have made it this far. My decision to back in 2008 to spin out the company was wrought with risk. Aquion had to cross that pre-revenue valley of death where we're spending a tremendous amount of money and time to turn lab results into something that was a bankable technology. At the same time, while the technology and the manufacturing piece is not well-defined. It's very challenging to find private investors who can stomach this much risk. A handful exist, but by themselves, it's rare for them to double down and make it happen. And it's even more difficult to get net new technologies like ours and Ambry's scaled to the scale that has been done without this kind of support. The partnership I had with DOE was critical for getting across this chasm from a research concept to a marketable product with proven performance. Furthermore, we continue to collaborate with the DOE, who are actively testing various generations of our products and have partnered with us to develop large in-house energy storage test beds. What can be done by the DOE and national labs to advance other breakthroughs? The DOE has a solid track record of encouraging good ideas and funding projects that can result in significant impact. However, one key aspect that is often overlooked early in the technology development process is the difficulty of scaling and manufacturing. Since all new energy technologies will be both materials and manufacturing intensive, focusing more on these aspects of the process early on would increase the success rate of translating lab results into market products. There is still a tremendous amount of important and interesting fundamental science and engineering to be done during the process scale-up and manufacturing side of any new energy storage technology. I would therefore encourage the DOE and the national labs to incorporate the considerations of scalability early in the technology development process, such that they are focused not only on what benchtop solutions make sense, but also how to turn a benchtop solution into a scaled, mass-produced, and relevant technology. Thank you for the opportunity to share Aquion's story and the attention you are devoting to energy technology development.
Thank you, Dr. Whitaker. Did we lose Chairman Smith? Okay. So I will recognize myself for 5 minutes and start with some interesting questions. Dr. Duke, the FY 2016 budget request includes a proliferation of battery and energy storage R&D scattered throughout DOE, including in the Office of Science through the Joint Center for Energy Storage Research, JCESR. Do y'all have a name for that acronym? JCESR? Okay. Which to me sounds like some kind of salad dressing, but in ARPA-E in the Vehicle Technologies Program, Solar Energy Program, the Hydropower Program, the Geothermal Program, and Advanced Manufacturing Programs at EERE, and in the program you manage, the Energy Storage Program in the Office of Electricity. So how does the department make sure the highest priority research is funded, and how do you avoid duplicative research?
Thank you for this question, Mr. Chairman. It's a very complex question, and I will try to attempt answering at least part of it. I would like to point out, first of all, that our particular program in the Office of Electricity is the first and original program at the Department of Energy. Most of the other programs entered the fray when grid storage reached a certain stage of development. ARPA-E does very interesting research aimed at cutting-edge technology. They are in the form of grants, and they have produced some very interesting projects like the Ambry project that we have heard about. We also interact with them. In fact, I was the person who suggested to the head of ARPA-E that he ought to be interested in grid energy storage. The Office of Science does basic work on mostly on the electrochemistry involved in storage, catalysis and things of that type. We don't do hydropower because there is an office, and hydropower is a well-developed technology which has some interesting things to advance, but it's not in the purview of our particular office.
Let me break in here for a second. Do you have a particular person who's tasked with watching these different programs, assessing their priority, and determining what's the highest level? And if so, who is that?
I believe not. However, we are putting together the QER program, which will provide more of a framework for not only grid energy storage, but also the whole field of grid-related energy projects.
Okay, well, forgive me, run short on time. Do you believe that grid-scale energy storage research receives the same priority within the department as vehicle battery R&D? Grid storage research, same priority as vehicle battery R&D.
Battery storage for vehicles has been sponsored for a long time and has produced some very good results on lithium ion. And it's also at a much higher budget level than
Well, when we look at the numbers in the budget request, now I have to tell you that grid-scale research looks to be a lower priority, just from the numbers in the budget request.
I would prefer to say that we have a lower budget, but it's not necessarily lower priority.
So, and that was my first question, who's assessing those priorities? But let me move on to my third question for you. Wouldn't it make sense to cut the overhead cost and risk of duplication by combining all of these various programs into one battery and one energy storage program at DOE? If yes, why not?
I would have to do this on a personal basis. Because policy decisions of that type are generally made by people in the administrative offices.
Okay. All right, well, I'm going to move on. All witnesses, very quickly, what impact could large-scale energy storage have on electricity reliability and reducing costs for customers? I mean, that's our goal, right? So just as quickly as you can, what impact could large-scale energy storage have on electricity reliability and reducing the cost for our consumers? Doctor, we'll start back with you. Actually, let's do it backwards. Doctor, let's start over on this end.
The impact ranges dramatically depending on location and depending on what kind of infrastructure and what kind of degree of renewables are local. In some places, it can have a profound effect. In others, it can be less profound. The message really is we need to figure out what locations can benefit most from grid-scale storage and implement those first and then let it trickle through. As Phil indicated, one of the key things to do is to first try and offset these peaker plants that are very rarely turned on. That's a low-hanging fruit. Also, finding places where we can level out wind or solar, low-hanging fruit. And from there are weak points in the grid that are also low-hanging fruit. So you phase this in at the biggest pain points first and move through. It's hard to put a dollar value on it, but there are already significant pain points.
Could you put a percentage on it?
Not for the entire country. For different locations, you can. It's a hard question to sort of average out because it's a time question and a location question. I'll defer.
Yeah, just quickly, I agree completely with Dr. Whitaker. It is very situationally specific, especially over these next few years. When proven out over this next decade and more, I think we could be at an electric system that could cost us 30% to 40% less than our existing electric system. Lovely. And largely because less assets will be involved. Right now, this is the most capital-intensive industry in the world. It's $3 of assets for every $1 of revenue that the industry generates across the entire value chain. And that's all because we're not using these assets very much. A lot of assets are laying idle in preparation for when we have our peak demand. So with storage fully developed and fully deployed, I think it could be a very, very different.
Well, I love hearing the 20% to 30% lower, but it just depends on what the investment is. Dr. Virden?
Well, thank you for the question. I like one part of your question a lot, which is the goal of energy storage is to keep prices down. Yeah. It'll serve certain very high-end markets initially, but the goal is to keep prices down. And it will have a huge impact on resiliency and reliability and robustness of the grid. Let me give you one example. We did an analysis for Puget Sound Energy. And they had three substations that were basically maxed out at capacity about 9 days out of the year. Texas has the same challenges in the middle of the summer. And they asked, where would energy storage have the biggest impact into maintaining the reliability of that substation and the distribution feeder? We did the analysis. It turns out you could put about a 3-megawatt battery that would run for 3 to 4 hours at a certain substation. Now, the key was they gave us real-world data, so we could make that analysis that saved them, given the ROI, they wanted $6 million over the other options, which were upgrading the transmission infrastructure, the distribution infrastructure, the substation. So with that battery, they can now meet, they believe, 90% of the challenges they have on that distribution feeder. And the main return on investments for them was inter-hour balancing. So balancing on that distribution feeder, the, you know, inter-hour requirements. T&D deferral was the next one. And we often talk about renewables, but the arbitrage part of that had very little ROI, even though the battery would spend 15% of the time. So as the previous witnesses said, there's no one answer fits all. You almost have to go utility by utility and what their specific needs are, almost down to the distribution level.
Dr. Duke, I'll let you wait on that quickly, please.
It's easy because most of the points I would like to make have just been covered.
Okay.
I think we're all agreed that we have to start things slowly and where we can find the most sensible results. Frequency regulation is already cost-effective in at least Texas and the FERC areas. Resiliency and emergency preparedness is an important one because when you need it, any price is good. And that includes the military bases. So military bases, islands, coastal areas, are beautiful for resiliency. Peaking is another one. But the whole thing is about getting the right benefit streams and increasing the asset utilization of the system as a whole.
Okay, thank you very much. And at this time, I'm going to yield to the ranking member.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Intel spends $5 billion a year on research and development. There are several drug companies that actually match that or exceed it. Why don't we see the same thing with regard to batteries? Batteries are over $100 billion a year in revenue. Why don't we see EverReady or Duracell or Rayovac doing the same kind of research that would, to a large degree, underwrite what you do every day? I think Dr. Whitaker alluded to that in his testimony, so I'll start over there.
There was a very interesting report done by the DOE perhaps almost 10 years ago now that assessed this. And one of the findings was that early on, I think folks recognized, this is for lithium-ion batteries specifically, that in North America, the return on investment on this kind of technology is a very long investment window. Japan and other folks in Asia were more willing to invest over that long period of time compared to what you might find in North America. So there was a general perception that this is a long-haul kind of technology development process, and that in some cases, I think it's very difficult for North American industry to double down on a very capital-intensive, very costly situation.
Mr. Giudici. Go ahead.
Yes, so to address the question, this is not unique to batteries. This is one of the energy challenges that the energy industry faces, especially the electricity industry, and it's part of the nature of the industry structure. There was an organization, the Electric Power Research Institute, that came together to try and spur R&D and demonstration projects. It's a very small budget. The vendors have a very small budget. The industry is not set to innovate in general, and so there isn't a model in this industry writ large, not just around batteries, to innovate and to invest in the kinds of ideas that could be breakthrough. And it's in part related to the nature of this industry. It's a highly regulated industry, both federal and state. It's not an industry that goes easily into change. When you have this kind of asset intensity, we have 30-year lifelong assets that they're dealing with. So they're not sort of with the mindset of let's keep reinventing ourselves every couple of years. And so I think that it really suggests why there's such an important federal and other public policy roles to bring us to a better energy future.
So are you suggesting that it's economic or that it is regulatory or that it's cultural? What do you think is the most important?
I think the fundamental economics do not reward innovation at this stage. And consequently, the regulations are not such that they're spurring change across the board. And it relates to smart metering. It relates to all kinds of aspects of the electric industry. It's not just as it relates to storage.
All right.
Yeah.
Doctor? Dr. Virden.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I'd like to point out that there are battery companies that are working on innovation. For example, a company in Pennsylvania called East Penn worked with us to develop the Ultra Battery, which has a cycle life which is almost 10 times that of a regular lead-acid battery. General Electric is another company that actively works on research. But I agree with you that, by and large, the battery industry is conservative. And the utility industry is conservative also, although we do have forward-looking utilities like Southern California Edison, Florida Power and Light, First Energy, American Public, you know, and various other companies of that type. But the federal impetus, I think, is helpful in bringing out the best in these companies and coaxing them towards innovation and new battery development.
Dr. Virden?
Yeah, with the Intel example specifically, they've got about an 18-month R&D cycle for next products and huge profit margins. And when you start wandering into the grid and the energy storage space, the fundamentals, and I think you said it here, are it's high capital, high risk, long-term payback, and fragmented market, and that makes for uncertainty.
All right. I see I'm almost out of time, so I yield back.
I thank the gentleman.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. May I have one more question?
The gentleman's recognized.
Thank you. Doctor, I'd like you to try to clarify your response to Chairman Weber's question earlier about who coordinates the various energy storage activities at DOE. Is it true that the Secretary established the Undersecretary for Science and Energy for that purpose?
Yes, that is true.
All right, thank you. Yeah. Now I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
And now the gentleman that drives a battery just about everywhere he goes is recognized. The gentleman from Kentucky.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I drove an 85 kilowatt-hour battery here this morning. It has four wheels, and that's probably the way to look at it. It's a rolling battery. Before I ask some questions about batteries, I want to ask Dr. Whitaker and Mr. Giudice about the role that patents play in commercializing technology. I think this is something that a lot of my colleagues here in Congress don't fully appreciate why these are in our Constitution, but can you tell me, do patents help or hinder you in your quest to commercialize this technology?
Thank you. I believe that maintaining a strong intellectual property stable, both patents as well as trade secrets, is critical. Folks will not invest or really take heart that you have something that's legitimate unless you have some documentation that establishes your right to you know, exercise your idea without being copied immediately. So it's critical. And that story really matters. On the other hand, I will say, especially in the energy technology space in general and batteries specifically, there's a tremendous amount of overlapping intellectual property right now that is difficult to suss out. And there's been a lot of really interesting court cases and a lot of other things that go with this. Chemistry materials are hard to patent and maintain patent. And there's a difference between right to practice versus right to block. So it's critical. I'm positive that we wouldn't have got the degree of investment that we have gotten without the 9 or 10 patents that we have and the worldwide patents that we have as well. It's super important.
Thank
On
you.
The other hand, you know, it doesn't hurt us for sure.
Right. Let me give Mr. Giudice a chance.
Sure. I share Dr. Whitaker's perspectives on this as well. As far as the patents are critical, intellectual property, without having our control of our intellectual property, we would not have attracted the investors we have. They are all motivated for long-term, significant, positive change for the planet and the country, but the financial rewards are what enables them to be able to write the checks for us. So I don't think that there's any doubt in my mind that without that, it would not have been the same kind of conversation.
Thank you. That confirms what my experience when I started a company at MIT with technology from there is that without patents, And you might think you would want all this to be shareware, but the reality is the investors will not come and invest the money in commercializing the manufacturing unless you have patents, and you have to be able to defend them as well. And I know it can get messy with overlapping technology, but that's what the courts are for, and we can get to the facts. So I'm sort of on a mission here in Congress to protect our intellectual property system, and it's, trust me, it's being attacked here right now. Quick, have a few questions. Dr. Juke, what portion of our storage capacity right now consists of pumped hydroelectric capacity on the grid, or just roughly? It seems to be the most conventional at this point.
It's the vast majority. Pumped hydro is a classical technology. All the utilities that have it bless the day when it was put in, because it helps them with peaking power. I mean, it's very difficult to live without it. Nonetheless, not very much is being built these days.
Why is that?
It's a combination of many of these plants were built to cope with the hoped for development of nuclear power. Because nuclear power likes to put out flat electricity, and the pumped hydro was intended to follow the load and do the up and down. Since nuclear power is not as big a component of our national energy budget as was intended, the impetus for doing pumped hydro is less.
Thank you.
It's also very expensive to build a new pumped hydro plant.
And how does it compare, like with batteries right now, the cost of pumped hydro versus, say, a chemical solution?
When you take into account a long life cycle, a pumped hydro could run for 20, 30 years easily. You amortize over that period, and the life cycle cost then becomes lower than most batteries. And that's sort of what we have to crack with battery research. The same is also true for compressed air energy storage, of which we have two very good examples in the world, one of them in Alabama, in Huntsville, and the other one in Germany. But we are now developing new compressed air energy storage. That's another bulk technology that amortizes over long periods of time and will give us good output.
Thank you very much. I see my time has expired. Are we going to do another round of questions, hopefully? I'll beg for some more time.
I don't have any objection to that.
Okay. I yield back then.
The gentleman yields back. The gentleman from California is recognized. That's right. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I also appreciate the subcommittee's indulgence to allow me to join today. Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the opportunity. Mr. Giudice, last week the majority passed a bill out of our committee that did cut funding for ARPA-E by 50%. In contrast, your testimony strongly recommends increasing our support for the agency and provides an excellent example of the critical role that ARPA-E now plays in advancing new grid-scale energy storage technologies. Can you explain on why you believe that ARPA-E is such an important part of our nation's energy innovation ecosystem?
Thank you for the question. Yes, ARPA-E is a relatively new agency, and it has done a remarkable job in the few short years that it has been up and running and operating. I do think that, as we were talking earlier, I think Ranking Member Grayson mentioned the comparison of Japanese spending on storage, $670 million a year, versus the budget that Imre Gook controls of $12 million a year. ARPA-E fills a little bit of that gap, and it's their mission, obviously, is much broader than just energy storage, but they are there to try and help create the breakthroughs that will serve our country and our planet for years and years to come. There is no alternative to that. There isn't a private sector group that's going to stand in to do that. There's not private investors through the venture capital type community that can stand up and take the lead on these kinds of innovations. The large corporations are spending very small amounts of money because it's not economically attractive to them to do that. So there is no one else to be able to take on that leadership. I strongly encourage the continued support for the RPE program.
Would your company and your technology be anywhere near where it is today without the early stage investments from RPE? Would it even exist?
I do not believe it would exist. I don't believe that, and to be clear, it was the campus research that got funded at MIT. So it was all done under a public private or public partnership with the RPE on that. And that was necessary to advance the technology to the point that we could attract and have conversation with private investors. So we weren't even ready for any kind of conversation with private investors when it was just a concept. That was necessary to prove out in the laboratories at MIT before it could be at all of interest to private investors.
So we see that, we know that you have a number of private investors, notable ones, and you're saying to me that the private sector could not have done this just on its own.
I'm saying they could, but they would not, because there is no economic package that makes sense on its own.
So in theory, it's possible that they could do it. They have the capacity.
That's right.
They have the capacity to do this.
That's right.
But the market alone doesn't seem to be able to move us in this sort of direction. It sometimes takes leadership through government-funded efforts.
Yes, that's completely appropriate. And you look at the profitability in the energy industry of equipment and services that are provided to this industry versus the profitability in the Intel example or the pharmaceuticals example, and they're just, the private sector isn't making the kind of money in this industry to justify spending money on concepts that could, in fact, bear great benefit for society. And this is a very appropriate role for federal leadership to stand in and say, let's figure out what might make sense here. And then when it's ready, the federal government can step back and the private sector can take it forward for commercial deployment and bear full fruit.
I think about how geography and circumstances forced a nation like Japan to move in certain directions, and our relative geographic situation, where we had abundant resources, we didn't have to think like they did, but I'm thinking about the way that that they began to dominate the car market, the design of their cars, they gained a competitive edge, and I'm worried about our nation keeping a competitive edge in R&D and also in the ways we can bring this technology to market, or the transfer that technology, transfer that knowledge. My time is up, Mr. Chairman, and I will yield back.
The gentleman yields back. Thank you. I recognize the chairman of the full committee, Chairman Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Dr. Whitaker, let me apologize for not hearing your testimony. I had to go give a quick speech, but I'm glad to be back. And I'm also sorry I didn't get to hear all the questions that were posed by my colleagues, so I may be plowing some of the same ground. But let me direct my first question to Dr. Jayuk, if I could. And it is this. First quick question is, you may have seen Tesla announced yesterday that they were announcing a new sort of home storage battery and a new industrial strength battery that presumably had better storage capability than others. I don't know how much information you might have read about Tesla's new batteries, but do you have any comment on them?
My information is roughly the same information you have. I hear the public announcements. Tesla has a very fancy luxury car. They have talked about residential batteries, but they really do not have any major part of the market. And I wish them well. Yeah. If they succeed, then energy storage will profit from it as a whole.
And I'm guessing it's incremental progress, not something that's explosive perhaps, or not something that's a major breakthrough. But they are on the forefront of car batteries in general, so that's why we tend to look to them maybe for some of the most the greatest advances in battery storage. Dr. Virden, you mentioned in your testimony that I heard that there are a number of gaps in our knowledge about developing the next generation battery and looking for the next breakthrough. Given those gaps, how do you want to give us any kind of a timeline, any kind of a prediction as to when we might make those kind of breakthroughs that will dramatically change the way we use alternative forms of energy?
Yeah, thank you for the question. I think what you're going to see is, from my perspective, is two phases. You have companies who have taken technologies that maybe have been developed over the last 5 or so years, and they're going to try to move those to the market, and they're going to try to improve them. Mm-hmm. We, for example, on that vanadium redox flow battery, which was a well-understood battery, it's been around for years, through some fundamental scientific investigations of solubility, we were able to increase the capacity by 70%, not incremental, but kind of revolutionary. So you're going to see, I think, those continued advances in the pipeline, maybe 5 or 10 years out, mm-hmm. are all kinds of ideas of, every battery has an anode and a cathode, just like your car battery, and an electrolyte in between. And you see all kinds of press releases about a new anode material that's 5 times better than anything out there. Mm-hmm. And it probably is. But as Dr. Whitaker was saying, when you put that in with an electrolyte and a cathode and put it together and then try to scale it, all kinds of things don't work. Materials start to fall apart. The chemistry isn't well known. There's side reaction. And usually what that leads to is loss of performance, loss of safety. And we as fundamental scientists don't understand those basic mechanisms. Okay. So in this ecosystem, you need that fundamental research that continues to move the state of knowledge along so companies can take that and utilize it. And the unique tools that DOE provides, they can utilize. Mm-hmm. Then you need companies to spin out and move it along. And we do really undervalue the challenge of scale-up. I think you're exactly right. In every materials process I see, in an experiment in a lab like this big, it works perfectly. Then when you want to make thousands of them, yeah, it doesn't. And so I think that is the challenge, is fill in that U.S. pipeline of yeah, fundamental science that can spin off and people can keep moving things forward. And with respect to that ecosystem and why it's so hard to move things out, there's 3,000 utilities in this country, and they don't have R&D budgets. And they don't have venture capital budgets. Okay. And we got private, we got public, we got co-ops. The fragmented market makes it very difficult for the ultimate end user to do the R&D.
Thank you, Dr. Burden. You said 5 to 10 years, so I gather that's what you're thinking. Yeah. Let me ask the other witnesses real question, real quickly, my last question. Oh, whoops. Sorry. And that is, and you're welcome to mention your own companies as well, in the case of our last two witnesses today, but what do you think is going to be the next great breakthrough? And Dr. Whitaker, will go to you, and Mr. Giudice, and then Mr. Gayak.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. There's a tremendous amount. There's a lot of leeway in that question, I will say. It's difficult for me to speculate on which vector the breakthrough should be in. There's energy density, there's power density, there's cost, there is lifetime, there is sustainability. These are all different, axes of innovation. And my sense is which axis is most important, I believe, is cost and lifetime. And the things that are going to move the bar in that are going to be the broad scale and adoption of maybe not necessarily completely different kinds of technologies, but understanding how to leverage our existing base to get it to the right price for the right durability. It's lifetime cost of electricity that matters. Electrons are dollars.
Thank you. Mr. Giudice, my time is up, so if you'll give me a brief answer.
Sure. It's going to be less than 3 years, and it's actually demonstrating the technologies that are now just getting to the market that are going to show the kinds of improvements that we need, and it is all about cost.
And what's the quick technology you're talking about?
Well, I'm excited about Ambry. I'm excited about Aquion. There's a few others out there.
Okay, great. Dr. Jayak?
We have driven down the cost of vanadium systems to a considerable degree. We are now thinking of taking that experience and going into new directions, but with the same general approach. Zinc iodide is a possibility, metalloorganics, and completely organic electrolytes.
Okay. Thank you all. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chairman Smith. And because this is such an interesting topic and we have such great witnesses, we're going to do a second round of questions at the risk of not catching our airplanes. And I appreciate your indulgence if you're available to stay for more questions.
Mr. Chairman, you can always give me a ride in your car.
It will get you there very quickly. At this point, I yield 5 minutes to Mr. Takano from California.
Yeah, do you have a battery as part of your freestanding house?
Yes, I have a 45 kilowatt hour lead acid battery that's 12 years old, and I'm looking for a replacement, by the way, so I want to talk to you after the hearing.
And you're completely off the grid, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Literally?
Literally, and this, and because of that, I understand the importance of batteries. I have 13 kilowatts of solar on my roof, but it does me no good when the sun goes down, if the batteries can't hold the electricity. And some days, because I'm off the grid, the power is literally just kind of spilling out. It goes nowhere and doesn't get saved.
I know our chairman is an expert of himself, so I thought I'd ask him a question, too. the question for all of you, if you can answer it, is really, where do you see the greatest potential for targeting future federal R&D funding to support emerging markets for grid-scale batteries, how we can scale, you know, do the grid level. I mean, just how best can we target our federal dollars? And if I were me, I would try to raise the R&D levels of spending. But what do we need to do next? What are the next things we could do, given if you believe that there's a role for the federal government in the basic research? Go ahead.
I'll take a crack. I sort of talked a bit about this already. My focus would really be to, I propose, and others have mentioned as well, that there are tens of amazing bench scale results already out there that could be breathtaking and super innovative, but getting them to the next level, getting them to something that is repeatable, demonstrable, that is scalable. There's a tremendous amount of fundamental and basic science in that process, and I often think that there's a boundary drawn between basic science and applied science that is maybe technically a little false, right? There's a tremendous amount of basic fundamental research in the process of making more than one tiny example of something. And why? How do we make that work? And energy technologies in general are about replicating and scaling. And there's this is one of the thing disconnects. It's so easy to do one thing, comparatively speaking, and having lived this, I can make you, and I did indeed make a very nice, very individual thing years ago, and my life's work the past 6 years has been making it repeatable.
Wonderful. Mr. Giudice?
Yeah, so from my perspective, I think from a federal leadership standpoint, I'd really move towards the demonstration and pull through from the market standpoint than just on the basic science. And I appreciate the purview of this committee is really more on the R&D side of it, but I really believe that there's an enormous amount of work to be done as the largest energy consumer in the world to start incorporating more of these different types of technologies in the mix of the energy choices that the federal government is making. And then working through all of the policies and issues around federal and state regulations to be able to fully value what the economics, the potential economic value of storage would be, and figure out ways to help make sure that gets as fully appreciated as possible as soon as we can.
I'm going to use the all of the above response on this one. And I truly believe it. You have to have the basic research to provide the long-term foundation. You're exactly right. There's some really cool technology ideas out there. But if you don't have the applied sciences, where most of the battery work starts to fall apart is when you take it out of the lab, put it in a real-world battery system, and it's that applied science that starts to troubleshoot and figure out why they're not performing the way they should. The theoretical densities are always really high. When you make one, it drops way down. And then you can't get the full feedback till you do demonstrations. And if you don't have all those parts of the ecosystem, it's hard to innovate rapidly.
Couldn't agree more. And that's what our program has tried to do, take the applied ideas, drive them through developing the devices, and then get them out on the field and see how well it performs in the field in the real life situation. And we need to have that entire chain from support of basic scientific research through the scaling into prototypes and beyond, and the applications for the first early adapters and demonstrations out in the field.
And just real quickly, do any of you believe that this getting to where we want to go can happen without without federal leadership? I'll take that as no one believes that. Okay, well, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. At this point, I yield myself 5 minutes. I can't wait. I've been given permission to take even more time. But the first thing I want to ask you about, I listened to your list of materials, Dr. Whitaker, in your battery, and I heard, you know, saline or seawater, salt water, and some other things, cotton, some magnesium maybe in there. I was glad I didn't hear unobtainium. You know, this is a problem that we have when we try to scale things from the lab, for, you know, theoretical to mass production, is sometimes you pick a material that's hard to obtain or hard to find at those scales. And I think one thing we need to be careful of, and I know you mentioned vanadium and iodide, which aren't unobtainium, those are familiar, is that we don't trade one set of moral encumbrances for another if we design materials into our batteries that aren't available domestically, and I'm okay with free trade, but are only available in politically unstable regions. And so could you talk to that issue? Mr. Giudici, you mentioned your battery technology. Does it have any unobtainium in it or any special sauce that we can't get in this country?
Yeah, so thank you for the question. The formation of the company was all about cost, and it was all about getting to lowest possible cost for the delivered energy solution, because we know that that's going to make the most significant impact. So the chemistries that we utilize were not public about. There's been a lot of research published on our chemistries and other chemistries from the groups out of way work on campus. We haven't disclosed that as a company what ours is, but it all starts with crustal abundance and local supplies as being a very, very important. And you're right, the initial work on campus was ultra pure materials working inside glove boxes and looking at, could this sort of chemical matching work as a battery? And the answer was yes. And as an industrial company now, we're doing things in open air, and we're doing things from industrial grade materials, and it's working very, very well. So I think it's an appropriate concern to have, because it's all about delivering as low a cost and getting as much of an impact as we possibly can. And we're quite comfortable that we're on a track to do that.
Would anybody else like to comment on that? Dr. Juke?
Yes. There are two charts that I keep in my mind when I think about new technologies. One is the chart of crustal abundances, which tells you how abundant the things are in general, and it also has a subsection on what materials are industrial materials. Vanadium is an industrial byproduct of the steel industry. Mm-hmm. So that's okay. The other one is the chart of electric potentials. You need materials that give you a large voltage window. Can't be too large if you're dealing with water, otherwise you're producing hydrogen and you may explode. But these two together define the limits of what we look into. And that's why we are interested in organics, which are basically carbon with stuff added, okay? And once you have the way to make it down pat, it should be fairly easy to produce them industrially in quantity.
Because we're using carbon and hydrogen and oxygen, right?
Yeah, and simple materials.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Now, I know that the constraints on a car battery are different than the constraints on a stationary application, where you just go for cost and cycle time, and you don't have to worry about weight. But what occurs to me is that you were talking about those fancy cars they make, and I heard my car being called fancy, but it's an 85 kilowatt-hour battery, and we're fast approaching 100,000 of those vehicles domestically. That's like 8.5, if I've got my decimal place in the right spot, 8.5 gigawatt hours of capacity running around in this country pretty soon. Is there a potential for using that wisely? Dr. Virden.
I think there is. There's, practical issues like if you do plug your car into the garage, who has liability for the battery if you're using it for, stabilizing the grid? Interestingly, we did a study of all the NERC FERC subregions and looked and said, how many of the cars could you put on the electric vehicles on the grid right now, region by region? And the places where you could put a lot of cars on the grid and the grid could deliver the electricity needed to charge and interact was the Midwest primarily, and it was the places that had a lot of coal and natural gas intermediate capacity. And interestingly, in the West, Washington State, Oregon, California, where we're hydro-dominated, you could put the least amount of vehicles on the grid and charge them because of our having to back water up behind the dam at night, and we don't have a lot of intermittent capacity. So people are looking at the idea. It makes sense. It could handle some of the distribution challenges, but there's still a ways to go to be able to get that transactive signal that would allow the battery to play in that grid market.
If you'll indulge one more question. That's fine. All right. Dr. Whitaker, I know your company is making a battery and selling it into applications that seem to involve different levels of scale. It's sort of the unique feature of your battery. You can scale it up and down. And this is really a question to all of you, but I'll start with Dr. Whitaker. To what degree are we going to be dealing with distributed storage, like at the home scale, versus centralized storage? And is there even a cost-effective place where it makes sense to do home storage? And I start with you, Dr. Whitaker.
Thank you. For sure it makes sense in some locations right now. Hawaii comes to mind as an obvious location where the cost of electricity is already so high and the penalties with selling back to the grid during peak solar production hours is great that people would just rather buy the battery and do it. And this is a fully distributed customer side of the meter model. There are other places around the world where it's even worse. People are, and I should point out that our most intriguing early markets are not domestic. We are exporting to a variety of places, the Philippines, Malaysia, everywhere else, where there are the dominant mode right now is distributed diesel generation, and they want to get rid of that. It's expensive and dirty. They would rather go to solar and batteries. They want the right batteries.
It's what I tell people that want to go off the grid. There's only one thing worse than the battery problem, and that's the generator.
The generator, right. And
I'm on my first set of batteries, but on my fourth generator.
Yeah. Yeah, a couple of our installations, we have some in Northern California right now. They've been going for almost a year now, and we really watch how often the generator comes on. That's a big satisfaction piece for the customer, how often. And usually we're lucky most of the time in our installations, it's just the weekly turn on to maintain integrity of the generator. That's what you want to see. That's a key. It's a key like win for us if we have that. So, but there are other places, to be honest, in North America especially, where electricity is very cheap, the grid's very reliable, and it's hard to imagine that those residences will be wanting to go distributed off-grid. It's from a financial perspective, it's a tough sell. But in those same areas, you may have some local grid issues or renewable issues where a more centralized storage infrastructure makes sense. So again, it's very locationally dependent.
Mr. Giudici.
I agree, and the markets are developing, and we'll see how they continue to develop. As you think through the 3, 4, 5, 6 years out, I do think it's going to make better sense to keep it at the grid level for the most part and be able to share amongst your neighbors both the storage and the distributed generation that might be on everybody's rooftop or on everybody's hilltop, but not have to duplicate the storage investment on a building-by-building basis. I think that there will be better economic value from a societal standpoint by doing that. It's a very natural role for the grid to be able to provide that at the distribution level and then be able to offset a lot of the other investments that would otherwise have to be made by doing it that way. But it's going to take some time to work out those business models and really be able to put that in place.
All right. My time is very much expired. And so I'll yield time generously to Mr. Grayson from Florida.
Thank you. The basic idea of a battery, the anode, the cathode, the electrolyte, that idea is roughly 200 years old. about as old as our country. And it is interesting when you consider all of the other technologies that have been developed in the meantime, the telephone, the computer, television, and so on, that we're still basically using the same model that was used 200 years ago. Is there any realistic prospect of moving beyond that model for energy storage? Dr. Whitaker.
There are certain thermodynamic realities about storing electricity in materials, and that those realities drive us to a sort of bipolar design where you have two separate material systems that retain different positive and negative charges when you apply a current to them. It's hard to imagine a different paradigm using the materials as we understand them today to allow this. It is sort of the anode and cathode are a natural reflection of thermodynamics, is the way I would put that. So my answer is, if you're talking about electrochemical storage, I don't think so. This is the paradigm. The key is to enhance our understanding and to maximize performance and explore new material systems and new electrode designs and so forth.
Mr. Giudici.
So obviously, I think a point was made earlier that as the grid exists now, 97% of the storage that's done on the grid is pump storage mechanically. Compressed air energy storage, two projects are going. So from an electricity storage standpoint, there's alternatives. But from an electrochemical battery standpoint, I don't think there are alternatives. And then the third form of storage, thermal storage, is obviously being utilized in lots of different applications, is another interesting way to store energy, not so much electricity.
Dr. Virden?
I would agree with the previous witness's comments. If you're trying to store electrons directly, the battery storage is really the only way to go about it. And it has practical challenges, which over those 200 years, I don't think we've had to face the real issues of batteries. But with transmission distribution constraints, renewables, we're now having to face directly, you know, how do we store energy in a battery?
Dr. Juke.
Yeah, I cannot. I need to agree with what you have heard so far. If you're doing electrochemistry, you have certain limitations on the system. Nonetheless, there are directions one can go in. I do not necessarily believe that lithium ion is the end all and be all, even for cars. We have things to go beyond. But they will not necessarily be, totally different.
Following up on my colleague's question regarding distributed versus centralized storage, it seems to me that one of the key factors in that regard, whether you store electricity or energy centrally or whether you store it household by household or business by business, is whether there are any significant economies of scale in the storage that would make up for the transmission losses that you would encounter when you distribute that energy from a centralized source. So please tell me, again, starting with Dr. Whitaker, whether you see any likely economies of scale in storage of energy that would offset the transmission losses.
Absolutely. I think depending on where it is, I keep on going back to this, but location specificity matters. It depends on how good your transmission and how close you are to a centralized power source. But typically, I mean, there's an argument for some degree of distribution to either eliminate the cost and the issues of either augmenting or establishing a more centralized traditional backbone system, or indeed, just by the straight efficiency losses associated with transmitting power. If you generate electricity in a location, you're best apt to store it near or at that location. This is happening in Germany right now. There's a self-consumption incentive wherein folks are actually driven to put batteries in their residence because they're generating electrons in their residence, and it's a more efficient system. So, yes, there is.
So just to be clear, do you see a feature of big storage, big batteries, or a feature of small storage, small batteries?
I see an intermediate situation. There's probably an intermediate thing where there's certainly not a single battery in the center of the country, right? And there's certainly not a battery in each of our pockets. There is an intermediate distribution of storage where there's an optimal distribution. Maybe it's at a neighborhood level or at a block level or something. If we were to really reduce this down to that kind of question, there is some optimal economy of size and distribution. I'm not sure exactly what it is, but it's probably more than, is probably outside the residence, but smaller than an entire city.
Mr. Giudici.
Yeah, so the market will tell us, and we'll see as it goes forward. I do think it's going to make sense, as I think where Dr. Whitaker was going, towards the distribution side of the business as the dominant place to have it make sense. And it's not so much economies of scale of delivering storage, but it's economies of the application. So on the neighborhood basis where clouds are coming by and we're all solar generating on our rooftops, those clouds are sporadically shutting off different rooftops as they cover up the sun. The storage at each house would have a much different effect than if it was storage across that whole small grid area. And I think that in terms of reliability and reducing costs, we're probably going to find optimal levels at those kinds of applications rather than any central generating storage or storage for every single household.
Dr. Virden?
I think it's going to be distributed at the substation level. So for me, that's, you know, several megawatts and a few megawatt hours. This is beyond frequency regulation where you have tens of megawatts. That's the higher value-added market right now. I see the home market behind the meter as longer term, except in a few places like California and Hawaii. That Tesla announcement, by the way, you'll get a battery pack. It's $3,000. You still have to buy the inverter, so it's $4,500. And that would give you about 7 kilowatt hours. That's not going to take you off grid. Our estimates to go off grid at a home, you're spending $15,000 to $20,000 or more. So it's still expensive. The community application to me makes the most sense because you spread the cost and get multiple benefits.
Dr. Chu.
Yeah, we consider distributed storage to be on the distribution side, which means substation and maybe slightly above or slightly below. Size from 500 kilowatt to about 10 megawatt. Those, I think, are the easiest applications. If we're going to go into residences, it's not so much residences as small businesses, campuses, business parks, and so on. There it makes sense to be behind the meter. Individual residences are probably a market considerably in the future.
Thank you. I yield back.
And as we close, I'm going to yield one more minute to my friend from California, just, Mr. Takano.
Just one quick question. What about any kind of systems that might generate hydrogen and store hydrogen, you know, just through electrolysis? I don't know the science of it, but and in combination with a fuel cell.
I can quickly comment on that. While this is completely technically possible and folks are still looking at doing it, one reality is the round-trip energy efficiency of that kind of system is at best 60%, maybe on the very best day. Most of the time it's 50% or less. And it's simply because the thermodynamics of converting water to hydrogen and then converting it back to water and getting electrons and storing electricity through that process is inherently inefficient. And so this is difficult to compete with the 80 or 90% round-trip efficiency we have in batteries. And that's a big, big deal when you talk about each electron is worth money.
Thank you very much. Well, in closing, I would say this has been a very enlightening hearing. Thanks very much in part to the quality of the witnesses and the quality of the questions. And it confirms my personal experience, which is batteries are not sexy, okay? You know, buckets of acid in your basement do not evoke envy from your neighbors, even though blue solar panels on your roof might. But the reality is, this is what's holding our country back. This is what's holding renewable energy back. In fact, this is holding nuclear energy back. This is holding coal-fired energy back. I mean, all these peak issues, they apply to any energy source that we have. And so I think even though it's not as sexy as some of the other topics, it is fundamentally very important to moving forward in our country is to have a better battery. The world needs a better battery. So I thank you for making that point and informing us today on some of the issues. I will say that we very much value your testimony today and the members. The record will remain open for 2 weeks for additional comments and written questions from members. And this hearing is adjourned.